Well, good afternoon. Welcome back to North Star Oasis. I'm your host, Jeff Williams. We're here for another action-packed week. And really, we're going to take one issue before we actually get on with the continuation of what we discussed last week. If you recall last week, we discussed the history of the Iowa caucuses, and we examined where the two major Democratic Party candidates, Bernie Sanders and Hillary Clinton, what their chances of success were. Well, today, in the second half of the show, we're going to focus on the Republicans. We're going to continue our two-part series on Iowa caucuses. But first, we want to start off with, I guess you can say, the theme of the week. Well, even before we get to the theme of the week, folks, this may very well be the last show of North Star Oasis. It may very well be. Breaking news. You see, tonight, either I or my producer, Dallas Pearson, we are going to win the lotto, and we are going to win that $900 to $1 billion pot, and that's going to force us to just be able to go and move wherever we want, to warm weather climates, or buy our own studio, whatnot. So if that should happen, now keep in mind there's a 292,600,000th shot at us, at either of us winning the lotto. So chances are we're not going to be able to have a big bag of Christmas goodies. You know, Christmas is in 350 days. But, you know, if we're not on the air next week, you know why. One of us will have won the lotto. But since the shot of that is extremely rare, we're already preparing for next week's episode. So, you know, we'll probably be back, even though I think, you know, secretly we kind of hope that we won't be. Chances are we'll see you next week. Anyhow, we had some news that happened just a couple of days ago, and that was a police officer in Philadelphia was shot. He was ambushed, and this happened, I believe it was yesterday. And we're going to show you some video from that right now.
Surveillance video shows a Philadelphia police officer ambushed while sitting in his marked cruiser. The officer, who was shot in the arm, then gets out of the cruiser and chases after the shooter and fires shots at him. Police say the suspect, who was also wounded, told them he was acting in the name of Islam and pledged allegiance to the Islamic State group.
The exact quote that he used, "I follow Allah, I pledge my allegiance to the Islamic State, and that's why I did what I did."
However, Philadelphia's mayor, who was in his first week on the job, was quick to downplay the connection.
This is a criminal with a stolen gun who tried to kill one of our officers. Has nothing to do with being a Muslim or following the Islamic faith.
The FBI and the Department of Homeland Security are helping with the investigation. The suspect was using a stolen police gun.
That is one of the things that you absolutely regret the most when an officer's gun is stolen, that it is used against one of your own.
Philadelphia's police commissioner is calling the shooting an assassination attempt. Bob McCall, Associated Press.
Okay, first of all, I want to pick that apart briefly here. First of all is Officer Jesse Hartnett, age 33. He was hit 3 times in the left arm on Thursday night, suffered some very serious injuries that will require multiple surgeries. Of course, he got out, and I have to commend this guy. You get shot in the shoulder, what do? You come out and you start firing back. And, you know, I think Officer Hartnett, you know, is one of the bravest people that we've seen in the police department recently. And, you know, especially when this is a stolen gun from a police officer. I mean, this is... not an easy thing to deal with. The other is the Philadelphia mayor saying, well, we're not going to make, you know, he may have been a Muslim man, but we're not going to make a connection. He claimed he did it in the name of the Islamic State. Now, if you've watched the show in the last few weeks, we've highlighted how ISIS was created. We've covered what's going on in the Middle East. But take a look at the fact that all of these people who are Muslims, who create acts of terror like this, including shooting innocent police officers, maybe the fact that he is a Muslim sympathizer with ISIS might have something to do with this. And yet, we have not heard a single word from President Obama in helping in the slightest. Now, if this was a white NRA member, we'd be hearing condemnations from the president. But no, this is a Muslim extremist who's been radicalized, and the Obama administration says nothing. That should tell you something. But speaking of the Obama administration, last week on CNN, there was a town hall meeting, and we're going to show you a clip from one of the questions that President Obama had to face.
As a survivor of rape and now a mother to two small children, you know, it seems like being able to purchase a firearm of my choosing and being able to carry that wherever me and my family are, it seems like my basic responsibility as a parent at this point. I have been unspeakably victimized once already, and I refuse to let that happen again to myself or my kids. So why can't your administration see that these restrictions that you're putting to make it harder for me to own a gun or harder for me to take that where I need to be is actually just making my kids and I less safe?
Well, Kimberly, first of all, obviously, your story is horrific. The strength you've shown in telling your story and being here tonight is remarkable, and so really proud of you for that. I just want to repeat that there's nothing that we've proposed that would make it harder for you to purchase a firearm. And now, you may be referring to issues like concealed carry, but those tend to be state-by-state decisions. And we're not making any proposals with respect to what states are doing. They can make their own decisions there. So there really is nothing that we're proposing that prevents you or makes it harder for you to purchase a firearm if you need one. There are always questions as to whether or not having a firearm in the home protects you from that kind of violence. And I'm not sure we can resolve that. People argue it both sides. What is true is that you have to be pretty well trained in order to fire a weapon against somebody who is assaulting you and catches you by surprise. And what is also true is there's always the possibility that that firearm in a home leads to a tragic accident. You know, we can debate that round or flat. But for now, what I just want to focus on is that you certainly would like to make it a little harder for that assailant to have also had a gun. You certainly would want to make sure that if he gets released, that he now can't do what he did to you to somebody else. And it's going to be easier for us to prevent him from getting a gun if there's a strong background system in place.
Well, first of all, there already is a strong background system in place. The NICS firearm background checks put out by the Federal Bureau of Investigation. It was established in 1998. First month was in November of 98. And I'm actually looking, unfortunately today we can't show this on the screen, but I am looking right off of the FBI website, fbi.gov, about us, /CJIS/NICS/reports/NICS_firearm_checks_-month_year.pdf. So that is the URL. I know you're not going to remember and you didn't write it down on the time I said it. So anyhow, November of 1998, there were 21,196 firearm background checks in the very first month that the system came online. So in those first 2 months, there were 892,840. There were in the first full year of 1999, there were 9,138,123 firearm background checks. Now, that's just to let you know a baseline of where we started from. But guess how many that we had in December 2015? Before I give you the month, would this shock you? That Black Friday, was it Black Friday? I got a report here. Black Friday breaks record with 185,000 gun background checks in one day. 185,000 gun background checks in one day. And last month, December of 2015, 3,314,594 background checks. In the entire calendar year of 2015, 23,141,970 background checks were conducted for firearms purchases by the FBI. I think the number of background checks that are being processed through is effective, and according to the FBI website, 700,000 permit applications have been denied since the system came operational in 1998. There have been 225,678,492 in the program's history through December 31st. And get this, every time President Obama brings up gun control, firearm sales and FBI background checks shoot up. And if you take a look at the law of unintended consequences, I don't think President Obama pays attention to that. But if he did, he would find that anytime he utters the words gun control or gun registration or does anything like his town hall meeting last week, gun sales go through the roof. So here he's talking about wanting to get guns off the street, but his very actions cause more gun sales to occur. So if you happen to be invested in any of the firearms manufacturing companies right now, you might have a good first quarter 2016, because I had heard that over 1 million background check applications were processed just last week alone, especially with the president's executive order and his town hall meeting. Over 1 million background checks. Actually, I'm sorry, I was wrong. It's 2 million background checks in 1 week. 2 million background checks in 1 week. And that just tells me he's really not interested in dealing with the problem. It's just an appearance. That's all it is. But really, if you own stock in any of the firearms manufacturers, I think right now you might make a little bit of cash, because the more the president brings up this news and brings this issue up to the forefront, then the more gun sales actually occur. And might be stocks worth looking at. I might even take a close look at that myself. Anyhow, we're going to go on to another video clip of a second question, and this is from Taya Kyle. Taya Kyle is the widow of Chris Kyle, the American sniper, who was one, a very, very lethal sniper in the U.S. Army. Very, very lethal. Navy SEALs. So he knew how to use firearms. Two, he was also killed by somebody with a firearm. So you would think that Taya Kyle, the widow of the American sniper, would kind of want, be anti-gun? Well, guess again. Let's take a look.
We're at an all-time low for murder rate. That's a big deal. And yet I think most of us in this country feel like it could happen at any moment. It could happen to any of us at any time. And I'm almost finished. Just when you talk about the NRA and after a mass shooting that gun sales go up, I would argue that it's not necessarily that I think somebody's going to come take my gun from me, but I want the hope. And the hope that I have the right to protect myself, that I don't end up to be one of these families, that I have the freedom to carry whatever weapon I feel I need, just like your wife said on that farm road. The sheriffs aren't gonna get to my house either. And I understand that background checks aren't necessarily gonna stop me from getting a gun, but I also know that they wouldn't have stopped any of the people here in this room from killing. And so it seems like almost a false sense of hope. So why not celebrate where we are? I guess that's my real question is, celebrate that we're good people, and 99.9% of us are never going to kill anyone.
Well, let me make a couple of points. First of all, thanks to your husband for his service, and thank you for your service, because extraordinary heroism that he and your family have shown in protecting all of us, and I'm very grateful for that. Number two, What you said about murder rates and violent crime generally is something that we don't celebrate enough. The fact of the matter is that violent crime has been steadily declining across America for a pretty long time. And you wouldn't always know it by watching television. But overall, most cities are much safer than they were 10 years ago or 20 years ago. Now, I challenge the notion that the reason for that is because there's more gun ownership. Because if you look at where are the areas with the highest gun ownership, those are the places in some cases where the crime rate hasn't dropped down that much, and the places where there's pretty stiff restrictions on gun ownership, in some of those places, the crime's dropped really quickly. So I'm not sure that there's a one-to-one correlation there.
Okay, the president is not sure if there's a one-to-one correlation there. Well, first of all, let me take a look at the illegal gun sales in the city of Chicago. Or not sales, but the confiscations. First of all, the city of Chicago, where President Obama had lived most of his adult life, where he was a community organizer, over 2,000, well, actually, it's even higher than this, but over 2,300 shootings. I think actually the number was 2,703. I looked at something just before the program began. It was around 2,703, and this was sometime at the end of November. So there were close to 3,000 shootings in 2015 in the city of Chicago. That's over 800 shootings per day, and it's a 21% increase in homicides in the city of Chicago over the previous year. The Chicago Police Department, as reported in July of 2015, in the first half of last year, they have confiscated more illegal guns in Los Angeles and New York City combined. Wow. And overall, according to the president, most cities are much safer than 10 years ago or 20 years ago. And you know what? Yes, most cities are, especially as states have passed concealed and carry. And you have a rise in legal registered gun sales. And then what you have now is some of the most restrictive gun laws, gun control laws, are the city of Chicago. And yet we're finding that homicides are increasing. Gun control, for what President Obama, Hillary Clinton are looking at, it does not work. It just does not work. And I think before we really get into, you know, some numbers, because I do have one more thing before I move to, you know, the next topic. Before we get into the numbers comparing the United States and Britain on gun control and gun violence, you know, I had to ask myself, where did all this stuff come from? I mean, I'm a historian. I've gone back in World War II and before, and there was never really any talk of gun control. There was nothing around the Korean War era. In our modern era, where did this whole thing of gun control really stem from? And you know what? I don't even think a lot of Democrats know. And what I found out is it's the Gun Control Act of 1968. And it originated in 1963 because President John F. Kennedy was shot and killed. And Lee Harvey Oswald, who was considered to be the gunman, and if you go back into to YouTube, to our archives, youtube.com/NorthStarOasis, scroll all the way down through all of our episodes, and we actually covered in our second episode last year, November of 2014, we covered the JFK assassination. But that's really where it started from. Lee Harvey Oswald purchased a rifle through a mail order ad in a National Rifle Association magazine called American Rifleman. And in congressional hearings that had followed, there was a ban on mail order gun sales that was discussed. But no law was passed at that time. It wasn't really passed until 1968. Franklin Orth, the executive vice president of the NRA at the time, he supported the ban on mail order sales, stating, quote, "We do not think that any sane American who calls himself an American can object to placing into this bill the instrument which killed the president of the United States." And that's where it stemmed from. So if you... And then I'm actually going to add one more thing here, and that is Senator Thomas Dodd was the person who had carried the bill. And it didn't really pass until 1968 after Martin Luther King Jr. And Senator Robert F. Kennedy were killed. And then the House Judiciary Committee had passed it. And then on October 22nd, 1968, President Lyndon Baines Johnson had signed into law the Gun Control Act, which banned mail order sales of rifles and shotguns and prohibited most felons, drug users, and people found mentally incompetent from buying guns. And that's really where it started. And I'm going to give you just one quote from President Johnson on that day. Quote, "Congress adopted most of our recommendations, but this bill, as big as this bill is, still falls short because we just could not get the Congress to carry out the request we made of them. I asked for the national registration of all guns and the licensing of those who carry guns. For the fact of life is that there are over 160 million guns in this country, more firearms than family. If guns are to be kept out of the hands of the criminal, out of the hands of the insane, and out of the hands of the irresponsible, then we must have licensing." And folks, that is where gun control started. Started right there, 1963, 1968, and the Democrats have never stopped. That was when they launched their attacks against the National Rifle Association, because the American Rifleman was the vehicle in which Lee Harvey Oswald used to purchase his rifle, and they have continually wanted to up the measures in taking guns off the streets. Legal guns, illegal guns, it does not matter. Take the gun off the street. And really, the problem isn't the gun. The problem is the person using the gun. So we have national background checks. We're going to continue to have national background checks. But now, let's take a look at the statistics between the United States, which under the Second Amendment, we cannot outright ban guns, and the UK, Great Britain, which has taken that measure starting in 1997.
So you think the US needs gun control? Well, did you know that the UK already tried gun control and it didn't really work? Instituted in 1997, here we see that the gun-related homicides didn't actually decline after the handgun ban. Rather, they continued to hover roughly around the same number as before. But focusing entirely on gun-related homicides neglects that people intent on murder find other ways to kill. In England and Wales, homicide by stabbing rates are 5 times higher than gun-related homicides. This is why total homicides are relevant. Again, we could look at the UK handgun ban of 1997 and see that total homicide rates also did not improve. The policy seems to have accomplished nothing. Per the UN, the UK has one of the highest per capita crime rates. You want to compare it to the United States? All right. Violent crime is defined more broadly in the UK, meaning their official figures can be adjusted downward, but even then, their rate remains near twice that of the US. The political rhetoric often implies that the US is overrun with homicides, but a comparison of 192 countries shows we're actually among the safest ones. And FBI data shows that the murder rate is actually improving. In 2013, it was 5.1% less than the rate in 2012. It was 10.5% less than the rate in 2009, and it was 18.3% less than the rate in 2004. So while gun control isn't making the UK safer, the US already is getting safer.
So that's a comparison between the US and Great Britain when it comes to guns. And as we just mentioned, every time President Obama opens up his mouth and speaks about gun control and wanting to restrict gun ownership, well, then gun stocks go through the roof because they went up actually 10% last week. And so We'll leave that part of that discussion where it is. But we did mention Chris Kyle. We are now going to actually take a look at Dom Rasso, who is another Navy SEAL, and he actually took after Hillary Clinton last week.
Brian Williams has been all over the news lately. And while he's getting the shaming he deserves, don't think for a second that there aren't thousands of other people out there selling you lies every single day. And I want to make sure you don't lose sight of another liar who thinks she can use the heroism of our nation's armed forces to promote herself as the next commander-in-chief.
I certainly do remember that trip to Bosnia. And as Togo said, there was a saying around the White House that if a place was too small, too poor or too dangerous, the president couldn't go, so send the first lady. And that's where we went. And I remember landing under sniper fire. There was supposed to be some kind of a greeting ceremony at the airport, but instead we just ran with our heads down to get into the vehicles to get to our base. But it was a moment of great pride for me.
So Hillary claimed she dodged sniper fire to get to her car. Here's a video of what really happened. And in the footage, I'm not sure I see any sniper fire.
That's Senator Clinton talking to me on the military flight into Tuzla. And these are the pictures we recorded of the greeting ceremony when the plane landed.
From the footage, I'm not sure I see any sniper fire. And what makes this truly disgusting to me is that when she was called on it, she dismissed it as if it was no big deal. Only someone completely arrogant, ignorant, and disrespectful of what really happens in war could say something like that. And all to get people to like you more. I've seen sniper fire, and there's nothing casual, nothing small, and nothing ordinary about fighting for your life on the battlefield. There is an undeniable feeling that we all get when we learn of the selfless stories being told about the men and women who have sacrificed everything on the battlefield for our freedom. Those stories humble us, and they inspire us to wake up every single day and accomplish even more. Hillary was willing to lie in order to take advantage of that feeling of gratitude and awe Americans have for those who serve. Oh, I was under sniper fire, and I know what it feels like to be in war. When she was called out for lying in that speech, she tried to make excuses, saying she misspoke or her memory was hazy and she's only human. In my 12-year military career, I never heard an excuse like that from my leadership. It's impossible to even imagine that happening. When you fight a war or you lead a country, there are no excuses. Every day for 12 years, I had a front row seat to watch the most awe-inspiring feats of human achievement anyone has ever witnessed. Nothing matches the feeling you get seeing guys suppress the fear of death in order to fight for their brothers and fight for the freedom of the men and women back home. When you see that, when you truly see it and live it and experience it, those moments that you shared on the battlefield, the heroism and the courage you witnessed, will drive you and inspire you and humble you every single day for the rest of your life. And to associate yourself with that, not by action, but by lying, is as dishonorable as anything I can imagine. Brian Williams is a joke, and he's getting the public shaming he deserves. But Brian Williams never ran for president, and he never laid claim to the title Commander-in-Chief. There's a different set of rules for people who do. And Hillary, the fact that you think the brave and selfless acts of our nation's heroes are yours to falsely associate yourself with, just to advance your career, proves that you are not worthy of the office you seek.
And I think that Navy SEAL Dom Rasso really had a hard-hitting statement with that. And I, as an Iraq War veteran, I can't agree more. You know, he said that in fewer words than I probably ever could say. So that's why I wanted to show it to you, because I was just blown away with how brutally honest that assessment is. And, you know, my hat's off to Navy SEAL Dom Rasso for that particular ad. Now, speaking of Commander-in-Chief, there are only 53 more weeks before we will be inaugurating a new one, since President Obama is at the end of his second term. 53 more weeks. So Inauguration Day 2017 will be coming up in one more year. And here's a little clip about presidential candidates by the numbers that I thought was appropriate just to kind of get us back into the presidential nomination contest topic.
Thank you.
Okay, well, I just thought you might find that a little bit interesting. Martin O'Malley and I actually have one thing in common. That is, if I were running for president, he and I would tie for poorest because of student loan debt. Now, the one thing that I can't figure out is how you can be an elected official and get the kind of salaries that they get, that Martin O'Malley has gotten, and still manage to have student loan debt on the books. I'd have to go back and take a look. Let me just do that really quick here. Martin O'Malley. I want to find out something on Martin O'Malley. We're going to do that right as we speak. I'm just going to look at his Wikipedia website. He served as mayor of Baltimore for 8 years, Baltimore City Councilor for 8 years, and governor of Maryland for 8 years. So out of 24 years of being an elected official, he should not have any student loan debt. I'm not an elected official, and trust me, I do this for free. So the money I'm making outside of North Star Oasis, because I make nothing here, is not really that much, because I'm still a graduate student. I'm taking an MBA program, so I'm still adding a little bit to my student loan debt. So Martin O'Malley should not have any excuse for being the poorest candidate running for president right now with having student loan debt, considering he's had so many opportunities for advancement with a halfway decent salary. But other than that, there's some numbers on the presidential candidate campaign trail. Now, since we had last really discussed the Republican side, we had two people who dropped out of the race. And going back last year, in 2015, we highlighted every single person who jumped into the race in the order in which they came in. And one of the things that I mentioned was after the Iowa straw poll, which was canceled last year, but around that same time in August, you're going to start seeing candidates drop out. And you're going to have a few who drop out between then and Thanksgiving. And that's exactly what happened. We lost Rick Perry, Jim Webb, Scott Walker, they all withdrew. And then just before Thanksgiving, Bobby Jindal also dropped out of the race. He might have actually dropped out in December. So that was the first slew of candidates to drop out right off the bat. And then it kind of gets to a lull, because historically we've seen this before, until after Christmas and after New Year's, and then the next batch of candidates start to drop out as they don't get traction and everybody's focus goes on to Iowa. And so we're going to take a look at the first candidate who exited the race. Happened just before Christmas, and that was because he was polling less than 1% in his home state of South Carolina, Lindsey Graham. And the reason he dropped out was simply the fact that that was the last day that you could withdraw from the ballot for the primary in South Carolina. I think it was December 23rd. It was roughly the 19th, 20th, this is like the 20th, I think. And that was the last time that you could withdraw from the South Carolina presidential ballot. And if you're only polling 1%, you're going to get embarrassed in your home state. And if you want to get reelected to the U.S. Senate, then you need to fare a little bit better than that. And so he decided to finally drop out. Here is his announcement.
Today, I'm suspending my campaign for president. I want to thank everyone who's taken this journey with me. You have honored me with your support. I believe we've run a campaign you can be proud of. We put forward bold and practical solutions to big problems, like retiring our debt and fixing a broken immigration system. This has been a problem solver's campaign. However, the centerpiece of my campaign has been securing our nation. I got into this race to put forward a plan to win a war we cannot afford to lose, and to turn back the tide of isolationism that was rising in our party. I believe we made enormous progress in this effort. 4 months ago, at the very first debate, I said that any candidate who did not understand that we need more American troops on the ground in Iraq and Syria to defeat ISIL was not ready to be Commander-in-Chief. At that time, no one stepped forward to join me. Today, most of my fellow candidates have come to recognize this is what's needed to secure our homeland. I'm far more confident today that our party will reject the Obama doctrine of leading from behind and will provide the strong leadership America needs to restore our military and take the fight to our enemies and do what it takes to make our country safe and preserve our way of life. This is a generational struggle that demands a strategy and the will to win. I will continue to work every day to ensure that our party and our nation takes on this fight. I'm suspending my campaign, but never my commitment to achieving security through strength for the American people. God bless our fighting men and women, and God bless America.
So that was U.S. Senator Lindsey Graham announcing he is no longer running for the presidency. And according to the Real Clear Politics average of polls for the state of Iowa, prior to his announcement, he was at 1% in the Gravis poll, 1% in the PPP poll, 0% in the Des Moines Register, and 0% in the CBS News YouGov poll. So he was polling really terribly, and he did the right thing, and he got out of the race. Now let's take a look at how New York Governor, former New York Governor George Pataki did. According to the Gravis poll, he was at 1%. And this was a poll released on the 21st of December. And the other three polls had him at zero. So we're going to give him his adios message, which is coming up right now.
Hi, I'm George Pataki. I was honored to lead the people of New York State as governor for over a decade. I brought to that job the values I learned growing up on a small family farm in the Hudson Valley. The values of hard work, family, faith, and community. But mostly what I brought was a belief in America that tomorrow would always be better and that as a free people we could accomplish anything. Today, too many Americans feel their children's future won't be as bright as their own. They are frightened by the prospect of radical Islam attacking us here and frightened by a government in Washington that grows more and more powerful. If we're truly going to make America great again, we need to elect a president who will do three things. Confront and defeat radical Islam, shrink the size and power of Washington, and unite us again in our belief in this great country. As governor on September 11th, yes, I saw unspeakable horror, but I also saw Americans united as never before, and what Americans can do when we stand shoulder to shoulder. On that day and the days that followed, we weren't black or white, rich or poor, Republican or Democrat. We were just Americans. We need to recapture that spirit, because I know when we stand together, there is nothing we cannot accomplish. While tonight is the end of my journey for the White House as I suspend my campaign for president, I'm confident we can elect the right person, someone who will bring us together and who understands that politicians, including the president, must be the people's servant and not their master. I know the best of America is still ahead of us. Happy New Year. May God bless you and may God bless the United States of America. I'm George Pataki.
And that was George Pataki's final message of the 2016 presidential race as a candidate. And so now we're going to be turning our attention onto the Iowa caucuses, which are happening in about 3 weeks, February 1st, that Monday. And I'll tell you this, I drove through Iowa. I went to Kansas at the end of December for a family reunion. And when I was coming through Iowa, I heard a lot of Ted Cruz ads on the radio. I also heard a few Hillary Clinton ads on the radio, some Bernie ads on the radio, and actually a Rick Santorum ad on the radio. So I know those four candidates are actively hitting the radio waves, but you know, we're going to take a look right now at the top four Republicans per the Real Clear Politics average of polls for the Iowa caucuses. So what we've decided to do was take a look at their ads. What is the message that these candidates are giving to the citizens in Iowa? And Donald Trump just released his first TV ad. And let's take a look.
I'm Donald Trump, and I approve this message.
The politicians can pretend it's something else, but Donald Trump calls it radical Islamic terrorism. That's why he's calling for a temporary shutdown of Muslims entering the United States until we can figure out what's going on. He'll quickly cut the head off ISIS and take their oil. And he'll stop illegal immigration by building a wall on our southern border that Mexico will pay for.
We will make America great again.
So that is the first ad that Donald Trump released. It is a simple 30-second ad, and there's an approximately $6 million ad buy for Iowa and New Hampshire. Now, I'm not sure what the disparity between, you know, where the money is, because, you know, according to the Wall Street Journal that you just saw, it says $2 million a week, well, for the next 3 weeks, but is it predominantly in New Hampshire and just a little bit in Iowa, or predominantly in Iowa and a little bit in New Hampshire, or split evenly? I don't know. But I can tell you that right now, he's in second place in Iowa with 26.8% on the average of polls. Fox News has him at 23%, Gravis at 31%, CBS News, YouGov at 31%, PPP, which is a Democrat pollster, has him at 28%, and Des Moines Register has him at 21%. So I'll tell you this, that a $6 million ad buy will probably, especially with that ad, it may only be 30 seconds long, but I think that that's hard-hitting enough that that may move the polls in his favor just a little bit more. So don't be surprised if you hear within the next couple of weeks that Donald Trump is getting momentum, because he's actually running a campaign ad right now, and he's not attacking anybody. He's not attacking his rivals through his campaign advertising. He may do that in his statements, his speeches, but he's not doing that in his television ad, and that might actually have an opportunity of moving the polls. Now, Ted Cruz, who is leading right now, 30.8% according to the average of polls. Fox has him at 27, Gravis at 31, tied with Trump. CBS News, YouGov at 40, PPP, he's slightly behind Trump at 25. Des Moines Register has him at 31. So he's made a six-day bus trip throughout the state of Iowa. And earlier this morning, he released this ad called Cruising to Caucus, and it's day number 5.
Christian background. I like the fact that he knows the Constitution. You know, he really wants what's best for this country, and that's what we need.
I started out supporting Hillary Clinton, but when I came today and heard Mr. Cruz's family values and his belief in God, that sold me. When there's a belief in God, it's just something. I think I've been reborn now.
So there was no real message other than an opportunity to show people throughout Iowa that Ted Cruz is attracting an audience in Iowa. And that's actually not that bad of an ad. I thought that Trump's ad was actually pretty good. And so that's where we're at right there with the top two people who are leading in the polls for the Iowa caucuses. The third person who, you know, there's a severe drop-off here between the third person. That's Marco Rubio, and he's currently with the average of 12. And let's take a look at his TV ad that was released yesterday.
Is eternity, the ability to live alongside our Creator for all time, to accept the free gift of salvation offered to us by Jesus Christ. The struggle on a daily basis as a Christian is to remind ourselves of this. The purpose of our life is to cooperate with God's plan. To those who much has been given, much is expected. And we will be asked to account for that. Were your treasures stored up on earth or in heaven? And to me, I try to allow that to influence me in everything that I do. I'm Marco Rubio, and I approved this message.
Well, and we're going to just go right into the next one. There's one other candidate who is polling around 10%, and that is Ben Carson. We're just going to write to his ad right now.
I was blessed as a child to have a mother who recognized the value of a good education. Despite having only completed the third grade, she understood that knowledge was key and instilled in me an appreciation for learning and reading. My own personal experiences have made me acutely aware that education is the ladder that can lead out of poverty and into realizing the American dream. In recent years, there has been a troubling trend with our government officials trying to dictate how children are educated in our country. This must stop, and Common Core must be overturned. Our education system needs to be run by caring parents along with engaged teachers and principals. The Department of Education and my administration will promote school choice by parents through support of school voucher programs and charter schools.
Now, I want to go right to the top four, Cruz, Trump, Rubio, and Carson. We're not going to have enough time to show the ads for anybody else, but, Jeb Bush is only polling 5.2%, Mike Huckabee 2.8%, Rand Paul 2.6%, Chris Christie 2.6%, Kylie Fiorina 2.0%, and John Kasich is 1.6% average, and Rick Santorum 0.8%. I can tell you this, that as the way it stands right now, unless something marvelous happens and any of these candidates push the needle heavily in the next 3 weeks, it's doubtful any of them are going to get a delegate. Carson, Rubio, Trump, and Cruz will come up ahead with some delegates come the Iowa caucus. And this time, they're bound. So unlike, previous years where, you can have a third place candidate like Ron Paul come out and actually take a lion's share of the delegates by stacking the conventions and getting the delegate selection. The Republican National Convention or committee had instituted binding rules, and so the preference poll that we're going to see on that night is how the delegates are going to be allocated. I don't know exactly how they're going to select them, but that's what it's going to be. So right now, we still have Donald Trump. We have Ted Cruz. Those two are in the driver's seats. Those are the front runners. Marco Rubio is a distant third, but he's still, if he can make some serious headways in other states, he still has a shot at the nomination. And then Ben Carson is most likely peaked. And what's come to my attention in the last couple of weeks is that a lot of senior staff for Ben Carson, they have left the campaign. They're reorganizing, so I don't expect to see him go further up. I expect to start seeing him decline. And then same thing with Jeb Bush. Jeb is more in a retrenchment strategy right now, which tells me that he is not going to be the nominee, because this late in the game, you don't start shuffling your money around and you don't start pulling out of certain locations. That's usually the last-ditch effort. We've seen this in the past with Rudy Giuliani and a few others who were just pulling out of one market only to get trampled on when that momentum pushed them right out of those other markets when those times came. So what we're seeing now is most likely you're going to have either Donald Trump, Ted Cruz or Marco Rubio will most likely be the nomination, or will get the nomination. We've got 3 more weeks until the Iowa caucuses, and we'll see, and we'll just keep abreast here and keep watching this as things progress in the next 3 weeks. But as we did last week, we kind of want to end with Iowa Republicans in a focus group, courtesy of Bloomberg. We did the Iowa Democrats last week. We're going to look at the Iowa Republicans this week. And like last week's, this was shot in May. So they're going to talk about some of the candidates who are no longer there. But, you know, we'll see what Iowa Republicans have to say about this year's field.
Do you look at this whole Republican field, all 12 or 14 or 15 or 9, however many end up running? Do you look at that field and think, that's a pretty good field. That's a good group to choose from.
I'm a little overwhelmed.
You're a little overwhelmed.
Yeah, there's a lot. It's like, whoo, there's lots of people.
I think that it needs to be whittled down and then to hopefully, you know, somebody strong will rise to the top. And I think that's scary right now with that big wide open field. I don't see a really good, strong candidate.
Does it matter to you whether that candidate has the potential to attract more women voters? Does that matter to you? Do you think about it that way at all?
No.
You don't think about it that way? No one. Okay. Does it matter to you whether the candidate who you support might have the prospect of being able to attract more support from Hispanic voters or African-American voters or other ethnic minorities? Does that factor into your thinking at all, or do you just say that's not part of it?
Not part of it for me either.
Not part of it. Okay. How many of you know much about Scott Walker?
What I like about him, I think he's battle-tested at least. You know, I'm open to everything, but we need somebody who's battle-tested, I think, but that will fight back.
Strong personality.
Yeah, and I think he will.
One of the things that's true about Scott Walker that's unusual is the fact that he doesn't have a degree from college. Is that important to you? Do you think a president should have a college degree, or is that irrelevant?
It's irrelevant.
I'm asking a show of hands. Is there anybody in the room who thinks that not having a college degree is disqualifying? You wouldn't vote for someone without a college degree?
I hate to say that, but I think that it's bothersome to me.
Right. Because?
I don't know why. I can't tell you, but it just strikes me as I think that the President of the United States should have a college degree.
If he was nobody, I think it would bother me, but because he's been a successful politician and a good governor, it doesn't bother me because he's proved himself.
Sorry, jump the hurdles.
Yeah.
He comes across as being genuine and having his thoughts in order about a lot of issues.
Obviously, the people in Wisconsin elected him 3 times in the last 6 years, so...
What do you know about Marco Rubio?
I like his background, and I just like the way he looks. And I saw him a little bit on TV last night. I thought, man, he's talking. He's talking good stuff.
Okay, you got a little bit of a crush on Marco Rubio.
I do. I think the kids call it crushing now. I'm crushing on him.
You know, he is the American dream. You know, I think that's essential that, you know, folks get refugees from Cuba, and he built himself up, and so he's kind of a self-made man. You know. I think he still gives a lot of credit to his parents and stuff, but I think that's what we look for in the United States.
You hear some Republicans who say, I think he looks like the future, but, you know, the last time we voted for someone in the middle of their first term in the Senate, we got Barack Obama, and he wasn't experienced enough to be president. So does it bother anybody in the room, the idea that Marco Rubio has only been in Washington for a few years and hasn't even finished one term in the Senate? Does that bother anybody?
I don't think Obama's problem is his lack of experience. It's his lack of integrity and his pushing things through and all of that. That has nothing to do with lack of experience. It's a character issue.
I second that.
So it wouldn't bother me.
Last week in the media, there was a lot of discussion about Jeb Bush and his views of the Iraq War, the war that his brother started. And I just want to know how much you guys have heard about that.
I wish he would have, and he should have, known that question was coming.
He was in a hard place, and those real good politicians can shuffle ball change out of those places like that.
It's in the past. Just let it go. Like he said, learn from it. Move on. There's more crap to worry about right now that's right in our faces.
Is there anybody in this room who is, A, who thinks Common Core is important, and B, who knows about Jeb Bush's position and is bothered by it? Nobody in the room.
I have to, what is Common Core? I guess, yeah. I don't understand that.
In terms of Jeb Bush, have you heard about his positions on immigration, and do they bother you? Anybody in the room?
I've not heard his position
on either.
On it.
If it's not any of those specific things that bother you, why is there nobody in the room who's either more enthusiastic or more curious about him?
I think he's his own man, but I think it's just such a negative connotation when you see that Bush name that people get they get turned off, and they don't even know why they get turned off.
Yeah, well, and I would agree. He's got a name problem that he's got to have to overcome.
That's the thing he's fighting. I think he'd make a good candidate. But I do think it's just because of the name, you know, he just is such a negative connotation that people just automatically get turned off.
I don't know if he can beat Hillary. Because it goes back to a Bush versus Clinton. What's going to happen? That scares me. Yeah, I don't have a problem with him or learning about him, but I am really worried.
Would it be any different than the Clinton side? So if we're looking for electability, maybe take both out and start with somebody new.
I think our country's a country, and it should be run by like a business, and I don't think it should be run like a family business. And that's what's going to happen, I think, if we get him in. And I just think he seems to fall a little bit into his brother's footstep. He's not anywhere near as charismatic as a dad, and that's too bad.
It's too bad that that's his last name, because I think people are really going to hold that against him, and I don't think they should. That's not fair, but it's reality.
What do you guys know about Carly Fiorina?
She's a woman.
That is true.
She talks pretty straight. I think she could hold her own with anybody in a bar fight or a discussion, you know.
Try against Hillary and see how
she
that
could give Hillary a run for her money.
Oh, yeah, I think she could.
I've heard positive things about her, that she is a good communicator and that she does know what she's talking about. I've heard positive things.
Nobody's enthusiastic. Anybody enthusiastic about the idea of another Rick Perry run?
I like Rick Perry, but I don't think he would be elected. He's just kind of in a third place horse, so to speak.
So, Crystal, are you interested in Huckabee this time around, or do you feel as though his time has passed?
No, I'm interested. I think he was smart to be on TV and get his name out there. So he is one I'm watching.
Okay. What about you, Craig?
I like him. I watched him. Used to watch him on his Fox show quite a bit.
Right.
And I think he's very intelligent. I think he really means what he says. But again, I don't know if he can bring the whole. That we're just, you know, I'm just so hung up on.
And that is what you heard from Iowa Republicans who are back in May, and perhaps some of their attitude may have changed as the race has progressed, but honestly, you know, there you have it. Iowa caucus is coming up in 3 weeks, but you will see us next week, same time, same place, unless we win the lottery.